reintroduce yourself again to the jury?
Yes, my name is Tim Horne. I'm a detective sergeant with the Burlington Prosecutor's Office Crime Scene.
And how long have you been with the Burlington Prosecutor's Office?
I've been with the Prosecutor's Office since 2007.
Did you work with any other law enforcement agency prior to?
Yes, prior to that, I started my career with Brown County Sheriff's Department. And from that point on, I worked with the East Hampton Township Police Department and Beverly City Police Department before I became employed by the Brown County Prosecutor's Office.
And at some point, you attended and graduated the Police Academy?
Yes, I attended Brown County Police Academy and graduated in 2010.
And what unit or division are you currently assigned to at the Prosecutor's Office?
I'm currently assigned to the Crime Scene Unit.
And is that the same unit you were in October of 2018?
That's correct.
Now your current position or title?
I've been recently promoted to Detective Sergeant of the Crime Scene Unit.
Can you just describe a little bit about the functions that you perform within the Crime Scene Unit itself, please?
Sure. The Crime Scene Unit is responsible to respond to various crimes throughout the county. When we do respond to those crimes, we process the scenes. And when we process the scenes, we document the scenes through photography, observations, collect and process evidence, and then we submit the evidence for examinations.
Now, training and experience. Can you go through a little bit of the training that you've had getting you ready for a crime scene, being a crime scene detective?
Yes. Prior to being assigned to the Crime Scene Unit, I was assigned to our police academy as one of the lead instructors out there. I then worked for our office and a couple other units. In 2011, they sent me to the New Jersey State Police Crime Scene School, which was a six-week course. And then since then, I've attended multiple what's considered in-service training sessions of various disciplines of crime scene, which include shooting reconstruction, bloodstain pattern analysis, fingerprints, arson investigation, scene processing, laboratory processing, scene management courses, and management courses as well.
Thank you. In the course of your career, approximately how many crime scenes would you say that you've processed?
Hundreds.
Now, approximately how many of those investigations were related to any type of a stabbing?
I would guesstimate probably at least 2 dozen stabbing investigations that I've completed.
Now, I'm going to draw your attention to October 12th of 2018. Were you working that day?
Yes, ma'am.
And were you involved in the stabbing investigation in the area of the Petro truck stop?
Yes, I was.
Approximately what time did you respond to that area?
I responded to that scene approximately 10:33 a.m. on the 12th of October.
And upon your arrival at the scene, what, if anything, did you do?
Upon arrival, I met with Detective Pavlov and Detective Regan from our office. Detective Pavlov is with the Bordentown New Jersey Police Department. He briefed me on the scene, told me what they had, and I observed the scene to be a very big truck stop area, and he briefed me on what had taken place and what he had recovered up to that point.
And what had Detective Pavlov taken anything into evidence at that point?
Yes, Detective Pavlov advised me that he did locate a knife that was suspected of being used in this investigation. He had the knife secured and was in his custody at that time.
Now, when you arrive on scene, are either the victim, Paul Stevens, or the defendant still on scene?
Neither individual were on scene. I was advised that the victim was transported to Helling Fold Medical Center in Trenton by Bordentown EMS as well as a Bordentown police officer.
Upon your arrival, did you learn that the scene had been cleaned at any point?
Yeah, upon my arrival, I observed the scene to be active, and I was advised by the investigators that the employees at the convenience store had attempted to start cleaning up the scene where they were advised to cease those operations.
Now, at some point, did you, you went over and investigated, obviously, the Covenant truck in this case?
Yes.
And what did you observe that truck to be?
It was a white tractor trailer, freight line, because I believe the make and manufacturer, white in color, two-door, Indiana registration. I can't recall off the top of my head. I remember it did having one number, like 15500, like 15500. Additionally, another number, if I remember correctly, 16500 was some type of identifying number. It was attached 53-foot enclosed trailer to it as well. It was parked alongside a group of other tractor trailers.
Now, do you recall what the weather was like that day?
Yeah, the weather that day was sunny, breezy, and cool.
Now, after arriving on scene, getting kind of caught up to date, what, if anything, did you do after that?
After being briefed, I conducted what's considered a walkthrough of the scene. To observe the scene, make any observations that, that I would see at the scene. Like I said before, it's a tractor trailer area. As I walked through the scene, looking for any other types of evidence, pieces of evidence or items of evidence, as I conduct that walkthrough, that's what I'm looking for. Bordentown Township had advised that they located suspected blood stains. During my walkthrough the scene area, I was able to locate blood stains that led from an area not too far away from where the tractor trailer was located at, but I consider to be the concrete pads where the diesel pumps were, leading into the convenience store.
Now, were these blood stains or blood pattern consistent with anything?
Yes, so the blood stains that I observed at the scene, specifically on the concrete pad, were consistent with what we describe as passive drip stains, meaning that there's a person bleeding, and as they're bleeding, that blood is just dropping passively towards where they're walking. Upon investigation and further look at the scene, I can see that these passive drops led into the store, the convenience store. Then inside the store, I saw some additional blood stains, suspected blood stains, which included what's called a swipe pattern, which indicates that somebody's bleeding. They're usually just moving, and they're moving their hand, it touches and leaves like a swipe pattern.
So you found both, you saw both passive drip and swipe in this case?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, after doing your walkthrough, did you ultimately photograph the scene in this case?
Yes, after doing my walkthrough, we placed what's called placards, which are known as evidence markers, at various items of evidence at the scene. I photographed the scene, take measurements, do a rough sketch, and then collect the evidence at the scene.
Now, in this case, what was the first thing that you photographed in
this matter? First group of photographs that I took at the scene are what I considered overall photographs of the tractor trailer and surrounding area in relationship to the convenience store area. So two lower right-hand corner, if I may go down and point it out?
Sure. Sure.
Thank you.
And were items collected during the course of that search?
Yes, they were.
Can you just name some of the items that were collected from that search?
Some of the items collected during the search of the tractor were documentation with the subject's name. Additionally, there were some other items that were collected that included some computer equipment. I want to say it was, if I recall, Rand McNally, some type of laptop or GPS, something. That was collected from the tractor.
In addition, obviously, were you able to locate at some point the defendant's wallet and personal identification?
Yes, and I believe you also need credit cards, if I recall.
And I'm going to show you what's been marked as S17 for identification.
Yes.
Is that a photograph of what was collected?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you just explain what was in the picture?
Yeah, it's a commercial driver's license in the name of Christopher Teeter. Address is 1002 South 7th Street, Bloomington, North Carolina. Additionally, inside that black colored wallet was a Visa debit card from M&F Bank. Unfortunately, I cannot read the account number.
Thank you. Statement of S17, Your Honor.
I'm sorry. No objection. Without objection.
Okay, we now see just S17 on the projector itself. Additionally, while you were in the tractor trailer, did you collect additional clothing?
Yes, some clothing, a passport, if I remember correctly, as well. As well.
Okay, I'm going to show you what's been marked as S18 for identification. Can you identify that photo?
Yeah, that was I described as a black colored jacket, which was located in the tractor.
Okay. And where was the jacket found in comparison to the defendant's other belongings?
If I recall, I believe it was back in the sleeper area of the tractor.
At this time, Your Honor, the state would ask me to ask
18. Mr. Shocking, no objection, and evidence.
Okay, on the projector now it is S18. Additionally, when you spoke to Detective Pavlov about this incident, did anything come up about the satchel bag?
Yes, he advised that when he located the weapon, it was in that area.
Okay. And did you have a chance to photograph that area as well?
Yes, I did. Captured it via photography and, of it, that, the items in that area, including that bag.
I'm going to show you what's marked as fully non-for identification. Can you explain what we see in that photograph?
Yes, it's a brown-colored bag that contained some type of card that she used for either fuel or something like that. Also had little, what I described, rubber bands that would be consistent with maybe somebody having some type of dental or braces in there as well.
Okay, and the name that's on that card?
Name on that card is Chris Teeter.
Your Honor,
it's
the same
state move as 49. Okay, no good.
So, in addition to the knife that was found and the piece of nail that's now laying next to it, you had testified just now that, is this the card that you mentioned?
Yes, ma'am.
And I'll try and zoom in. And the little rubber bands?
Yes, ma'am.
In this case. Now, were you the one to ultimately photograph the defendant in this case as well?
Yes, ma'am, that's correct.
And did you notice anything consistent with these rubber bands pertaining to the defendant?
It appeared he had some type of braces or dental work going on.
in photographing the truck itself, you had mentioned you walked around the area. Can you explain again to the jury, what you were actually escorting, used by using this map, can you explain and show the jury exactly where you had a chance to walk? Screen now, that's what you were referencing as the L scale?
That's the L scale.
And why do you do that?
We do that so you can see the approximate shape and size of the item we're taking a picture of in relationship to that scale that offers a measurement. I believe that scale is in millimeters.
Now, in addition to the outside, you had mentioned that you also surveyed the food counter store area, is that right?
Yes, I did.
I'm going to show you what's marked as S21.
Yes. This picture here is a photograph of the door looking into the store from this, the one side looking towards the other side of the store where the victim is located by the trucks.
S21.
Mr. Masciocchi, I think I'm just going to assume there's no objection unless you make an objection.
That's fair, Your Honor. The series of pictures that counsel has in her hand, there's no objection to that.
Very good. Thank you.
Okay, so again, just from the map, if you wouldn't mind, can you show us which side of the store we're looking at through this door right now?
So that picture there, looking, that picture to the door is looking from this side of the store here to the other side of the store over here.
Is it fair to say this is the door then that the victim entered through?
Yes, that appears to be the door the victim entered. Then he exited through that other door that you see there in that picture. So he's located on that other side of the patrol.
Now we see marker number 6 in this picture. What would that speak to?
That would, if I remember correctly, I think 6 was another suspected blood stain that observed on the floor inside that store.
Thank you. Now, in addition to the floor, did you find blood anywhere else?
Yeah, there was a what I described as a deli-style counter in the store, and that's what had what I described as a swipe pattern. Initially, what I observed the suspected blood stain with the swipe pattern where somebody's bleeding and come in contact with an object similar to this, it leaves a mark that we consider a swipe pattern.
I'm going to show you what's been marked as S22. And can you just describe what that is?
Yes, that's a placard 7 would be kind of hard to see there, but it's on that far side, closer to that door, is what I consider a swipe pattern. The person coming across, coming into contact with the counter. Line or baseline to take measurements of the suspected blood stains. 90-foot as my A mark, and then the 86-foot line as my B mark when I took my measurements of the suspected blood stain that I observed on the concrete pad.
Thank you.
If I may, I'm sorry. And then this just is, this is supposed to show you the entrance door to the store, and then this other one here is the exit door to the store as well.
Thank you. Thank you. And the exit door would have been the door that the victim was ultimately laying out at?
Yes, ma'am.
Photographing and collecting all the scene, collecting all the evidence on the scene. What did you do after that?
Upon completion of all the documentation of the scene and collection of evidence, evidence was placed into my county issued vehicle and secured. I then responded to the Bordentown Township Police Department.
Did you have the occasion on that day to meet with the victim, Paul Stevens?
No, I did not. The victim was in surgery at Helene Fault and receiving medical treatment, so I wasn't able to go meet with him there. Bordentown Township had been able to retrieve his clothing and transported the victim's clothing back to their agency.
Now, did you have occasion to meet with the defendant in this case on that day?
Yes, I did.
And why would you photograph a defendant?
We document the individual, his clothing, his condition, and what we see prior to collecting any items that we are to collect.
In addition to photographing, do you also take a type of a swab from the defendant?
Yes, there was, it was considered a buccal swab was taken for DNA purposes in order to develop what was considered a DNA profile.
And is that ultimately sent to the lab?
Yes, that's sent to the New Jersey State Police Laboratory in Hamilton, New Jersey.
Okay. Let me show you what's in mark as S23. S23 and then S44. These are pictures that you yourself took?
Yes, ma'am, they are.
Okay. And these obviously are the defendant's person?
Yes, they are.
And where are these pictures taken at?
They are taken at the Bordentown Township Police Department, where the defendant was located at upon my arrival. This is the way he was presented to me.
Had you been advised if anything had happened or changed, or he had changed his clothes or anything along the way while being processed or transported?
No, I was not advised of. He was in when I met him at the position.
S23, I've put on the screen, and I'm going to put a picture of S44. And just to zoom in a little bit.
We'll check the orientation as well. It's sideways on the screen. There's a button.
Clothing and any other items that we might have.
Okay. So showing those been marked as